So all the participants, now we have our third session on modeling and simulation of mechanical system by Dr. Abhishek Jha. Abhishek Jha is an assistant professor at Robotics Engineering Department at Karunya Institute of Technology and Science, Coimbatore. He had completed his doctorate degree from VNIT Nagpur. His research interest includes robot programming by demonstration, kinematics and dynamics modeling of robotic system and machine learning. He is a member of Association of Mechanism and Machines of India and Robotic Society of India, RSI. So, Abhishek sir.
Yes, sir.
Just wait, sir. Sir, now you are co-host. You can share your work,
sir. Am I audible properly, Sanjay, sir?
Yes, sir. You are audible.
And is this screen visible?
Yes, sir. It is clearly visible.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Sanjay, sir. So a very warm good afternoon to all the organizers as well as the participants. And in this particular session, we'll be discussing about the modeling and simulation of mechanical systems using MATLAB. Okay. So we have just witnessed a very wonderful session by on the thermal engineering and use of MATLAB for modeling of solar systems. Okay, and we have observed that it is a tool which can be used for developing the advanced systems. So in this presentation or in this particular session, my approach will be to demonstrate you how you can start with the fundamentals, how you can start with the problem solving approach in MATLAB. So this is the agenda for this particular talk. We'll start with the introduction to MATLAB. Then we'll discuss about the mechanical system modeling. And finally, we'll see some problems, how we can start using MATLAB for modeling of simple mechanical systems. So let's get started. So as we all know that mechanical engineering is in the heart of the design process. So whatever we see around us, that is some form of that contains some form of design. So design is considered to be the key area where mechanical engineers or mechanical engineering has a major role to play. And nowadays, due to boom of artificial intelligence and artificial machine learning and the Internet of Things domain, what we are trying to achieve is the computational thinking. So right now, the conventional mechanical engineering design or mechanical engineering problems are slightly shifting towards the computational thinking approach or computational thinking process. So if we talk about the computational thinking process, it is nothing but the process of formulating problems and getting their solution through some kind of analysis, through some kind of software means. So basically, this computational thinking approach has its roots in computer science, but slowly it is being adopted by the various disciplines. So if we talk about the computational thinking, so it has got three steps. First is the problem specification, where we formulate the problem first. That problem may be domain specific. Then in the second step, we try to develop certain algorithmic expressions. We try to develop certain programs for solving that problem. And this algorithmic expression or searching for the solution is user specific. And the final step is solution implementation and evaluation. So once we are done with the solution, what we can do, we can implement that particular solution or implement with that particular algorithm for achieving certain goals. So here two key points can be observed, that the problem specification is domain specific. So whenever we talk about the mechanical engineering domain, we may have different categorization, like we may like to work on the design problem or thermal engineering problem or production problem. So according to the domain, what we can do, we can fix the problem. And computational platform is user specific. So we are having n number of platforms nowadays. You may use MATLAB, you may use Python, you may use C language for getting that algorithmic expression or for developing those solutions. So you may have observed that in last 10 to 15 years, the paradigm has gradually shifted from C language to Python. Okay. So there are n number of tools which we can use to adopt this computational thinking. So if I discuss about the MATLAB, so we all know that MATLAB is a versatile tool which was initially developed to deal with the matrices computation, numerical solution, but nowadays it is being extensively used in several domains. So there are n number of domains or n number of problems that we can solve using MATLAB. So if we talk some of this about some of the specifications of MATLAB, then due to its user friendliness, it is considered as a high level programming language. Then second advantage is its vast amount of built-in function. So there are n number of functions, variety of functions available to solve the different problems of different domains. Then comes the powerful plotting and visualization tools. We all have observed in the previous presentation that it has got a very good plotting and visualization capability that we can extract to any extent. And feature extensive documentation and online support. This is one feature of the MATLAB which distinguish it from the some other computational platforms like Python and C language. It has got extensive documentation and online support. And due to this extensive documentation and online support, and another factor is the adaptation of the industry standards. So MATLAB adopts the industry standards, and because of this, MATLAB is one of the best available computational tool what we have. And most of the industries, particularly if we talk about the aerospace and automotive industry, they use MATLAB extensively for the system development. So this is the conventional workspace of the MATLAB. So work environment of the MATLAB, we have got a command window where we can get certain outputs. Then there is a directory pane, then workspace pane, command history. So these are the conventional work environment. Then nowadays we have three different tabs in the command window. First one is the home tab, which we just saw. Then second environment or second app tab is the apps tab. So nowadays the use of apps is being preferred. So MATLAB has summarized multiple or many of the toolboxes in the apps form. So what we need to do, we just need to give the inputs, okay, and it can come out with the outputs. We need not to code the things. Then the third tab available in the MATLAB is the plots tab, where we can plot the various data related with the different domains. And most important environment or most important part of MATLAB is the home tab or the documentation tab, where all the documentation or all the help files and the notes or the examples are listed. So this is one of the best way of learning MATLAB. One can start with the documentation part, one can start with the examples given in the documentation and start learning MATLAB. So if we talk about the workflow for MATLAB programming for a new user, so how can he or she start using MATLAB? So first thing is to write scripts and functions. So that means scripts are the programs where you specify your program. Scripts is the file where you specify the program details, and functions are the specific program files where you we can keep some specific calculation or specific information we can specify. Suppose, for example, if we want to calculate the circumference of a circle, then 2 pi r is the formula. So if we can define 2 pi r as a function file, and every time if we give input, if we provide radius as the input parameter, that function may result as the circumference of the circle as the output. Then second thing that novice users has to consider is to minimize the number of expressions comprising a program. So at the initial level, one is advised to keep the program as simple as possible. Then third point may be to use the help files extensively. One can use the help files to know about the things, to understand the working of a particular functions. Then try to use graphical output. So this is very helpful, or this is very useful in interpreting the results. And another important point is verify by independent means. So this is most important point in using MATLAB or any other computational tool, that we need to verify the results by independent means. Why verification is needed by independent means or independent tool? It is important that if we talk about the MATLAB or any other computational platform, it is just like a calculator sort of thing. If we give certain input, definitely it will provide certain output. But whether that output is desirable or not, or accurate or not, or correct or not, it's the user's responsibility to judge the output. So whatever results you are getting from the MATLAB, we cannot judge those results by means of computation. We should always refer to some independent means or some sort of procedures or some sort of other means to verify those results. So this is one important step in using any sort of computational platform. So if we use the MATLAB or any other language for solving the specific problem, then what may be the probable steps? So first step is the formulation of the problem itself. So we need to analyze the problem statement and formulate the problem statement first. Then once the problem statement is finalized, the next step is to outline the possible or approximate form of solution. So before before the actual solution of the problem, what we need to do, we need to identify, we need to outline what may be the probable solution or what may be the probable form of solution. This is the only way through which we can judge whether our solution obtained by MATLAB is correct or not. Okay, so we need to outline the possible or approximate form of the solution. Then the third step is to adopt the requisite structure in the MATLAB environment. So MATLAB is a vast tool. So we can define a requisite structure, we can define a proper structure for a particular problem. Then next step is to formulate the problem statement programmatically. So if you are using the MATLAB environment, then you need to code your program, you need to code your problem. And if you are using the Simulink or some other tool like SimMechanics, Simscape, etc., then you need to define the model structure. You need to define the model structure for that particular problem. And once your problem statement is ready, what we can do, we can solve the problem, we can interpret the results, and we can verify the result. But most important part is the problem formulation itself. Once the problem formulation is done, we can get the right form of solution. So let us talk about a little bit about the mechanical system. So mechanical engineering, we all know that it is a vast field and mostly dedicated to the design, development, and analysis of the physical systems. So mechanical engineering has a very broad area of application, right from design applications to thermal applications to production applications. And if we take a simple example of this versatile field is the automotive design. So automotive design is no more a mechanical engineering problem. We need to go for the electrical systems. We need to go for the digital systems. We need to go for the thermal system. So all kind of analysis is involved in designing an automotive system. So all such computations, all such calculations can be performed using these kind of computational tools like MATLAB. So if we talk about the MATLAB, particularly for mechanical engineering domain, there are few toolboxes available, particularly in the automotive domain, then aerospace domain, and event-based modeling and physical modeling domain. As I discussed earlier, that automotive and aerospace are the two industries which uses MATLAB extensively in their development process. So we can find many functions and many toolboxes related with the automotive design and aerospace design in MATLAB. Particularly for mechanical system, we do have certain physical modeling systems like Simscape, then Simscape Driveline, electrical fluids, multibody. So in these systems, physical modeling systems, a simple mechanical system can be approximated into some sort of system, and then we can perform the analysis of the system. So we'll see in few examples how that can be achieved or how that can be done. So how to start? So we discussed about the MATLAB, we discussed about the mechanical engineering domain, but how can we start building our own application, or how can we start solving our own problems in MATLAB? So conventionally, there are three approaches of using MATLAB. First one is the conventional programming approach, where we can code each and everything and run the program and get the solution. Then second approach is the model-based approach, where we can use some modeling techniques like available in Simulink, Simscape, to build the model of the problem, to build the model of the function, and then solve it. And third way of using MATLAB is to use the interactive tools and apps. So n number of toolboxes are available in the app form. So we just need to give the inputs and outputs for solving a particular problem. So these are the three conventional ways. We'll look at these three ways one by one. So first way is the conventional programming. So what we can do or how we can start, we can describe the problem statement in the MATLAB script. Then we can define the appropriate solver or toolbox or functions for that particular problem. Then once that solver or toolbox is identified, we can solve the problem. And finally, we can interpret the solution. So these are the four steps involved in conventional programming. So let us switch back to MATLAB environment and see how we can use this conventional programming technique for solving the problem. So this is the problem what we are going to solve using the first technique, the conventional programming technique. Here in the figure, a slider crank mechanism is shown. And what we need to do, we need to perform the position analysis of this slider crank mechanism. It is a very common classroom problem that we have we all have solved in the classroom. So in this position analysis problem, usually the dimensions of the links are given, like A, B, B, C are given. This angle is given. What we need to do, we need to find the position of this particular point C as well as inclination of this particular limb. So this is the problem in hand. This is the problem what we have in our hand. So this is the position analysis problem. So what is the conventional way of solving this particular problem using some trigonometric concepts? What we can do, we can get the coordinates of point B as well as C, and then using some trigonometric functions, what we can get, we can get the this particular angle as well as the coordinate of point C. So just like the conventional way, what we can do, first we can identify what is the given data. So in this particular case, the link lengths are given. So AB is given as 0.5 meter and BC is given as 1 meter. Then this angle phi is also given. So phi is given as 45 degrees. The next thing what we look for the position of A. So as in the conventional method, we fix one of the reference point in the link. So we take A as the origin of this chain and define all the coordinates with respect to A. So if we take A as the origin, this becomes the 0, 0. So here the coordinates of XA and YA are 0, 0. So A has been fixed as the origin of this chain or fixed reference point. So the coordinates of this particular point are 0. Then next we need to find the position of point B. So point B can be simply find position of point B can simply be calculated from this trigonometric relation, that XB is equal to AB cos phi and YB is equal to AB sin phi. So using these two expressions, we can get the coordinates of point B. And next is to locate the coordinates of point C. So as we can see in the given geometry, that point C lies in the x-axis itself. So again, YC will be 0. The Y coordinate of point C will be 0. And then we need to find the X coordinate of C. So using a little geometrical analysis, we can formulate one particular equation in terms of XB, XC and YB, YC to get the coordinate of C. So this is the particular quadratic equation, XB minus XC square plus YB minus YC square is equal to BC square. So this particular equation, this particular quadratic equation can provide us the value of XC, which is unknown till now. And once we get the XC, what we can get, we can compute the phi 2, that is the inclination of link BC with the horizontal. So this is the conventional way of solving problem. So once you are implementing MATLAB for solving this particular problem, you have to follow the same procedure. You have to follow the same procedure for solving this particular problem. So this is the MATLAB script for solving the position analysis problem of the slider crank mechanism. So first of all, what we do, we try to chalk out the given dimensions or given data. So in the first box, you can see we have specified the link lengths or the given data as AB 0.5, BC 1, phi, pi by 4, XA, YA equal to 0. So this is the first part of the program where we specify the given data. Then comes the second part of the program where we make certain calculation. So first calculation that we are making in this particular program is the computation of XB and YB, coordinates of point B. So this is done by using the same formula which we discussed in the previous slide, like AB cos phi and AB sin phi, and YC is also 0. So here we made the first computation. Here we made the first computation of XB and YB, and then comes the equation. So this is the equation what we are trying to solve in MATLAB. So first thing, or the most important thing in this particular problem, is to how to declare the equation. So if you observe closely this particular program, till now A, B, B, C, Phi, X, A, Y, A, all the values are known. All the values are known except XC. XC is unknown that we are trying to, find out. So XC is unknown. So this is one particular way of specifying the equation in the symbolic form. This form what we have used is the symbolic equation declaration. So here you can see XB is known, YB is known, YC is known, and BC is known. The only unknown is that XC. So what we can do, this is one functionality of MATLAB where we can utilize the symbolic expression. So this is nothing but the symbolic equation declaration. Why I am saying symbolic? Because all the other values, AB, BC, XA, YA are known at this point. But XC is not known. So just like we solve in our pen and paper approach, so in a similar manner, we have specified this particular equation. So this is the equation declaration, what you have to observe closely. And second thing is that how you solve that particular equation. So we are again using a MATLAB function called solve. So this is a dedicated MATLAB function which is used for solving the equation. So this particular solve function can take symbolic expression as input and solve the equation. So this solve function or solve equation we are using in this particular program for solving the this particular quadratic equation. So this is the syntax of this solve. You can observe solve is the function name. Equation is the equation name which we are passing to this particular solution. And in the single quotes, we have specified the unknown variable. So since this quadratic equation, in this particular quadratic equation, XC is unknown, so we need to specify the unknown variable. So this expression will solve the quadratic equation. Okay, and as we all know that while solving the quadratic equation, we always get two roots. So to check for the two solutions, what we can do, we can call the evaluate function and check for the two roots. So this eval function will evaluate the solution obtained using solve function and will display the two roots. So we need to call that those roots one by one. And as per the geometry of the given problem, we have certain constraints also that XC1 should be greater than XB. For this geometry to lie on the first quadrant, what is the constraint that XC should lie on the XC should be greater than XB. That means this particular point C lies must lie on the first quadrant. So that kind of constraint we can implement using this conditional statement. So once we get the two coordinate values or two roots of the equation, what we can do, we can check it. We can check it for the applied constraint that whether it is greater than XB or not. And if it is there, then what we can do, we can take the value of XC as per the applied constraint. And once XC is known, then we can go for the computation of that angle. So phi 2 can be calculated using arc tan function. So this is the expression what we are using from the analytic expression. So this is the analytic expression for computing this particular angle. So you can simply observe that this program is written just like a pen and paper approach. This program is just written like a pen and paper approach, what we use to solve a particular problem. In the similar fashion, we specified each and every parameters. We defined the equation. We are solving the equation and we are checking for the constraints also. So once you solve this particular problem, we can get graphical solution like this. So this is showing the solution. So from the graph, we can judge that the point C is close to somewhere 1.3 3 meters and the angle we need to measure, the angle we need to compute. So let us switch to MATLAB environment and see how we can implement this particular program. So is this slide visible? Is this MATLAB screen visible to you?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Sure.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. So this is the MATLAB code for that particular problem, what we have just seen here. In order to run MATLAB, we need certain more commands or certain essential commands. So here you can see that clear, CLC, close. So these are some essential commands which are necessary for writing any script. Then here the variable declaration part has been done. So you can see that AB, BC, A5, all values have been defined. Okay, so this is the first part of the program which was listed in this small box. Then we go to the second part where we are making calculations. So here we have simply defined the calculation part XB, YB, YC. Then we have declared this equation. Then we have called the solver for solving that equation. Once the equation is solved, what we are calling the two roots of the solution which we just obtained. So once those roots are obtained, what we can do, we can check the constraints. So this was the problem constraint, what we have, that XC1 should be greater than XB. So that is the constraint what we have for this particular problem. And once XC is fixed, what we can do, we can compute the phi. So here our problem solution is over. We got the angles, we got the coordinate of XC. So here technically our problem is over. In pen and paper approach, technically our problem is over at this particular point. But if we are using some sort of computational tool, then what we are interested in, we need to print the results. So here fprintf function, which is again a function for printing the result in the command window, is used. So what we are printing, the all the calculated values. So we calculated XB, YB, XC, YC, and phi2. We want to print that value in the command window. So this is for printing the results in the command window. We can use the printf function along with the specified format and variable name to print the result. And then comes the plotting part. So again, for this particular problem, we can go with the linear plot. So here XA, YA, YB, XB, YB have been plot, linear plots. Linear plot has been used over here. Then we can define the labels. Then we can define the title of the plot. And some additional thing has been done. We want some sort of text in the graph that this is joint A, this is joint B, this is joint C. So that you can also specify using text command. So this is the solution. This is the program structure for that particular program. If I run the program, so simply I'll get the same graph which I displayed in the slides. So this is the graph what we obtained, and let us go back and see the solution. So in the command window, we are plotting, we are putting the results, we are printing the results. So here is the result. So what we can we are getting XB as 0.3535, YB as 0.353, XC as 1.28, and YC as 0, and phi2 as -20.7048 degrees. Sorry. So this is the solution what we are getting. So we got the graph and we got the numeric values too. So this is a simple position analysis problem. Now you can complicate this problem by altering the dimensions or by altering the inputs. So this is a this was a simple position analysis problem. Suppose you are going to synthesize this mechanism and you do not have dimensions for fixed dimensions for AB and BC, and what you are planning, you are planning to check the various dimensions. So in that case, instead of a single value AB 0.5, BC point BC as 1, what you can do, you can define a vector, so which may contain n number of values, okay, for your problem. And in that way, you need to perform this calculation again and again, then you can implement that same problem, the same structure in a looping format. You can apply a loop and then it can solve the synthesis problem. So in synthesis, basically, we do not have the fixed dimension. We need to check for the different dimensions of the links for appropriate design parameter. Okay, so the same problem concept, the same approach can be used for solving the synthesis problem. So this is the first way or first approach where we can code the things, we can code the problems and get the solution. So this was the first approach. And another important point is that once you are done with the solution part, you got the graph, then what you can do, you can go to the publish tab of the editor and there is a option called publish. Okay, so if your program is run successfully without any error, then you can go for the publish option. So if you go for the publish option, you can publish your program in the form of PDF, in the form of PPTs or any other format like HTML. Okay, so this is the published version of that program. I just click the publish version. So all the program data along with the result have been published by MATLAB with appropriate titles. So table of content is there, then whatever description we define in that particular program, that is there. Then whatever segments of the program we wrote, variable declaration, then calculations, printing of the results in command window and result plot. So these were the four segments of the program, all are there. And then finally, this generated graph is also there. So this is one another feature of MATLAB which we can utilize. So let us go back to our slide. So this was the first approach, the conventional programming approach, where we can utilize the conventional pen and paper approach to code the problem and get the solution. Now we'll move to the second approach, which is model-based approach. So in model-based approach, we need not to code a single line. We need not to code a single piece of code, a single line of code. So there are a few tools or few options available in the MATLAB, particularly in Simulink, where we can use the different models to define a system. Where we can use or connect different models to define an integrated system. And once that integrated system is defined, we can solve the problem. So for that particular thing, we need to select the appropriate model component first in the Simulink environment. Then once those components are selected, what we can do, we can define the connections, we can define the parameters. Once the connections are established and parameters are defined, then what we can do, we can run the simulation. And once the simulation is done, we can interpret the result. So one particular toolbox that we are going to see today for mechanical system modeling is Simscape. So Simscape is a particular environment for modeling and simulation of physical systems. So many physical systems from mechanical, electrical, or hydraulic domain, we can simulate inside Simscape environment. It is an integrated part of the mechanical standard license. Then it provides fundamental building blocks from these domains that you can assemble into models of physical components, such as electric motors, hydraulic valves, and ratchet mechanism. So there are certain inbuilt models in the Simscape environment, which we can explore to define, to develop a system, and we can perform simulation. And because Simscape components use physical connections, your models match the structure of the system you are developed. So this will be just like developing an actual system. Then next important part is that if we can utilize the MATLAB-based command structure, MATLAB-based function structure, MATLAB-based problem specification for our specific problem. If some of the systems are not available, if some of the models are not available, then we can use MATLAB to define such kind of equations, such kind of parameters for our problem in hand. So let us see an example from Simscape. So here we are trying to build a Simscape diagram. We are trying to build a Simscape model. So the objective of this particular problem is to model a simple mechanical system and observe its behavior under various conditions. So we all know that mechanical systems can be, many mechanical system, dynamic systems can be approximated into the simple spring mass damper system. So that approximation we will utilize in this particular problem for understanding the modeling of the system. So here we can see a spring mass damper system, and a force F is acting on the mass. So this force F will generate certain displacement, and the velocity as well as the position of the mass will change. So this is just a simple approximation, or a linear simple approximation of the suspension system of the car. So in order to model the car suspension or automotive suspension system, we usually go for these kind of approximation. So this spring mass damper system represents the model of the car suspension system. So it consists of a spring, a damper, and mass and a force. So there are certain parameters in this model: the intensity of the force, the mass, the stiffness of the spring, and damping coefficient, that we can alter in the MATLAB environment to see the system's response. So let's get started. So for this particular problem solution, for solving this particular problem, we need to go for the Simulink or Simscape based environment. So first step is to open the Simulink library browser, create a new model. So you can access the Simulink library browser from your workspace here. So this is the Simulink library browser. If you click this, this browser will appear. If you open the Simulink, this browser will appear. So once you this browser is open, you can analyze that there are n number of things listed over here. There is Simulink, then aerospace block set, then Simscape, sim events. Okay, so n number of options are available. N number of options are available. Okay, we need not to code anything. We just have to drag the things and connect the model. So once this library browser is open, we'll go for a new Simulink model. So once you open new Simulink model, one blank window will appear. So this is the blank window where we'll drag, or where we will build the model. So this is the workspace where we'll work, and this is the library from where we'll get the different tools or different models for building our system. So third step is to open the Simscape, then go for foundation library, mechanical and translational elements library. So this is the third step that we need to follow. So let us do that. So first we need to go for Simscape, then go for foundational library. Then there are n number of options available: electrical, hydraulic, mechanical, magnetic, mechanical. We'll select the mechanical. In mechanical, there are certain subdivisions, so we'll select the translational elements. So once you select the translational elements, it will list the available options. So here in this particular window, we can see mass, then translational damper, translational spring, translational friction damper, and mechanical translational reference block. So first we need to select the mass. So simply click this mass and drag it to the workspace. So this mass has been dragged. Then we'll select the translational spring. We'll select the translational spring. Sorry for the inconvenience, my system is hanging a bit. So I have stopped the video. So translational spring, then translational damper, and we need two mechanical translational reference blocks. So these are the five things needed. So what we did, we just dragged those models from the library. Now we need to reorient them. So simply click this model and press Control R. So it will rotate. Press Control R. Participants, is it visible properly?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Visible.
Thank you for your responses. So these are the few components what we have just taken from the library. What we need to do next? So we have taken the mass, translational spring, translational damper, and two mechanical translational reference blocks into the model. Then we have oriented the block in a sequence. So these are the five things that we simply drag. Next, we need to reorient them. So we have already reoriented using Control R. Next, we need to define certain connections. So what we need to do, we need to connect the spring, damper, mass, and the translational resistance. So how can we connect these things? So just have a look over here. So whenever you touch the end of the block, a reference line or a reference connection will be generated. Okay. So this is the thing. So simply click this end of this particular thing and try to generate a connection. It will automatically guide you for that particular thing. Now, once you are done with that, you can simply
alter the connection. So just now I defined a connection between translational spring and translational damper. Simply in a similar way, I'll join the other ends too, and I'll simply realign it like this. And now I will connect this translational reference with the spring and damper system. Next thing is to connect the mass to this particular thing. So let us define a connection between mass and this particular thing. So we have just defined the connection. So this is the connection between spring, damper, mass, and the reference block. Okay, so this is the connection what we just established. We have connected the translational spring, damper, mass block, and one of the mechanical translational reference block. So this was the first step. Then in next step, what we need to add representation to the force acting. So if you refer to this particular system, there is a force acting on the system, force F. So what we need next, we need a representation of the force. So for representing that particular force, or for applying that particular intensity of force, we need a force block. So force block we can add from this particular path. We need to go to the Simscape Foundation Library, Mechanical Sources Library, and select Ideal Force Source Block. So this is the thing, Foundation Library, Mechanical Sources, and there is a Ideal Force Source Translation, Ideal Force Source available. So we'll drag this particular force to the system. So the force source has been added. So we can just reorient this force source. So we have added force source, and we need to connect that force source with the mass and with the other reference block. So one connection we can define like this, and one end of the force source can be added to the other reference. So we simply drag the component and define the connection. So this particular connection we established, we have added ideal force source to our system. So in the next step, what we need to add sensors to measure speed and position of the mass. Since while applying the force, there will be certain displacement in the mass, displacement in the spring, and there will be certain change in the velocity of the system. So that to sense that particular changes in the position as well as in the speed of the system, we need certain sensors to measure that. So for that particular thing, we need to place the motion sensors. We need to place the motion sensors. So that for that particular thing, we'll add ideal motion sensors, translational motion sensors block, to our system. So again, from the same library, SimScape Foundation Library Mechanical, there is a tab called Mechanical Sensors. So we'll simply click that Mechanical Sensor, and there is a Ideal Translational Motion Sensor block. So we'll just drag that block into the model, and we'll define the connection. So this is going to connect to the mass and to the reference block. So this is the system what we just, we have just taken from the library. So this particular connection we can define. So this is the connection defined, and we can add this first point with the So this is the ideal translational motion sensor. We just incorporated into the system. Okay, so till now we can observe that we have not written a single line of code while doing this analysis. We have not written a single line of code or a single piece of information into the MATLAB. So this was the step what we just did. We have placed the motion sensor. The next step is to need the sources and scope. So whenever some changes are taking place in the system, we need to visualize those system. We need to analyze those systems. So for that, we need scope blocks. So scope blocks can be found in the regular Simulink library. They are the part of the Simulink part. So we need to incorporate, we need to get the two sources block and signal builder block. Signal builder block and two sinks. So let us do that. Signal builder can be found in Simulink sources. So just go to the Simulink, then go to the sources block. And there will be a signal builder block. So this is the signal builder block. We need to drag this. So signal builder block is done. And next we click sinks. So there are different types of scope. We'll select the two simple scopes, scope number one and scope number two. So one scope will be used for viewing the velocity. So what we can do, we can simply rename it as velocity, and second scope we can name it as position. So these are the two scope blocks we just taken from the Simulink library, and we have renamed it as velocity and position. And these blocks will be used for observing the velocity and position changes. And there is a signal builder block. So this is the signal builder block, which will generate the necessary signal for the model. So this step we have just finished. We have named the two sinks as scope blocks, as the velocity and sensor blocks, and we have added the signal builder block. Next, we need certain converters. Since we are using the Simscape environment, and two blocks we have taken from the Simulink library. So Simulink is a different environment and Simscape is a different environment. So whenever we are interchanging the environment, we need a signal converter, because in Simscape basically we are dealing with the physical modeling of the system. We have some certain physical systems like spring or damper or mass. Okay, and in Simulink we are mostly dealing with the things in the signal domain. So whatever forces and displacements are taking place, we need to convert that into those effects into the signal domain. So therefore we need some converters. So every time we connect a Simulink source or scope to a Simscape diagram, we have to use an appropriate converter block. So to convert Simulink signals into physical signals and vice versa. So using this converter block, what we can do, we can convert the Simulink signals into physical signals or physical signals into Simulink signals. So that can be imported using this Simscape utilities library. So let us do that. Simscape utilities library Simulink PS converter. So again, we need to move back to the Simscape library. Then we have to look for utilities. In utilities, we are having different type of converters. So we need PS2 Simulink converter and Simulink to PS converter. So we need two PS Simulink converter and one Simulink to physical signal converter. So what we need one physical signal Simulink to physical signal converter, one, and two physical signal to Simulink converter blocks. Okay, so that we just imported, and we need to connect those blocks in this particular format. So this is the thing. Simulink PS will be placed over here. So first we need to connect the signal builder with the Simulink PS converter block, and then we can attach this particular signal to ideal force source block. So this maroon line indicates that the connection has been established. Then simply we can use one physical signal converter block to translational motion sensor to PS converter, and then we can connect this to velocity scope, and the second output of this translational motion sensor we can connect with the second converter, and we can connect it to the position block. So these are the connections what we just defined. We have connected the two converters, physical signal to Simulink converters, with the velocity and position sinks scopes, and we have connected one Simulink to physical signal converter with the signal builder and the ideal force source. So this was the step number 10. Then the final step is to incorporate a solver. So each topology, distinct physical network in a diagram, requires exactly one solver configuration block. So just we defined a the model parameters or the model configurations we have defined, and to solve this model configuration for various inputs, what we need a solver configuration block. So that can be found in Simscape utilities library. So that we need to incorporate next. So this is our workspace. Again, utilities library. So this is the solver configuration block that we are going to use. So we'll just import that solver configuration block, and we need to connect it. So here that need to be attached, and connection is to be made. Okay, so this is the solver configuration block we just added to the system, and it needs to be attached to the mechanical translational reference. So this is the block diagram, which is complete for modeling. So this is the modeling part, what we have done. Okay, we simply dragged up few components from the library, and we have defined the connections. So one thing you must know, or one thing you might have observed, that for using these systems, you must have the fundamental understanding of the system you are trying to model. Okay, then only you can select the appropriate blocks from the library, and then only you can perform the certain simulation. So this is the complete system block. What we can do, we can save it now. So we can save the block. So simply we can use file, and save option, and you can give some appropriate name and save it. So once you save the model, that model will reflect in your current folder. So SMD2 is the name given to that model we just generated. So this is the model we just generated. So our modeling part is complete. We have modeled the spring mass damper system. Now next step is to analyze the simulation. But before going to start the simulation, we need to define certain parameters. So first, so you have to remember that whatever model we generated, that is having some default values. So we need to change those values. So first setting or first parameters we will vary is the solver. So for this particular problem, we need to select the solver ODE23T from the solver options. So simply go to your model. Then there is a tab called simulation. So click that. Then there is a drop-down menu. You need to select the model configuration parameters. So select this model configuration parameters. So depending upon the type of problem you are trying to build, there might be certain different solvers. There might be some different configuration parameters that you need to define. So a new window will open. So this is the window. So you can see over here, the start time of simulation is 0, end time is 10 seconds. So that is default. And here is the solver. So the current solver is ODE45. So we need to change it to ODE23T, I guess. Yes, ODE23T. So that is the solver that we need to select. And maximum step size we need to change. So it is auto, we'll change that to 0.2. So once you specify the maximum step size, you can also define the minimum step size, and there are various other parameters that you can change. But initially, I'll suggest you to go for the system configurations, and once you understand the complexity of the system and the behavior of all these parameters, then only you try to change the default parameters. So for this particular system, ODE23 is needed. So that we selected, and we have changed the step size. So simply click the apply button and OK. So now we have changed certain parameter of the this model configuration. So now we can run the simulation. So for running the simulation, there is a separate play button. So you can simply click this play button and your simulation will run. So this is just running the simulation. Depending upon your system configuration, it may take different time to compile and solve. So the simulation has been done, but nothing is visible. So I told you that the two scope blocks will be used for displaying the result. So first double click the velocity block. It will display the velocity plot, and then click the position plot. So it will display the position plot. So are these graphs visible properly? So what we can observe that we are getting a flat line only. We are getting a flat line only. So that flat line is due to the default settings. So simply click this auto scale parameter, so it will scale up the diagram. So on the velocity diagram, on the x-axis there is a timing 0 to 10 seconds, and in the y-axis there is velocity changes in meter per second. Sorry. And in the position graph, what we have in the x-axis, again we have timings 0 to 10 second, and in the y-axis we have displacement in meters. So you can see in this particular simulation that the certain velocity disturbance occur at the 4 second, and then after certain disturbance that velocity again settles to zero about 6.5 second. So there are certain changes in the velocity due to that application of force, and the same thing can be observed in the displacement graph also. So there is some initial displacement due to application of force at the 4 second, and that continues up to 6 second, and later it again the displacement settles down to zero. So this is what the graph we observe. So in the beginning we can observe that at the beginning the mass is at rest, so there is no displacement, there is zero displacement or zero velocity. Then at the 4 seconds, as the input signal changes abruptly, the mass velocity spikes in the positive direction and gradually returns to zero. So you can see that this is the spike in the velocity in the positive as well as in the negative direction during the course of action in between 4 to 6 seconds, and then it again settles to zero. And in the position graph also, you can observe the same phenomena. The mass position at the same time changes more gradually on account of the inertia and damping, and stays at the new value as long as the force is acting. So this displacement is valid for 2 seconds. So 4 to 6 seconds, there is a certain displacement in the mass when the force was applied, and as soon as the force is removed, so this displacement again goes to zero. So this is the meaning of what two graphs, what we just got from the simulation. Now in this system, what we can do, we can change the different parameters of the simulation. So what are the parameters? We can change the force profile, we can change the model parameters, and we can change the mass position output units. For the considered model, we have the three parameters. We can change the force profile, then model parameters, and mass parameters. So let us change those three things. So for changing the force profile, what we can do, we can select the signal builder block and apply the changes. So let us go to the model, and there is a signal builder block. So if you double click this signal builder block, a graph or input signal for force will appear. So this, we can see that this force is applicable zero. There is no force in the system for 0 to 4 second. At 4 second, some intensity of force is applied, and that remains active up to 6 second. And that 6 second, it again changes back to zero. So we can alter this parameter. So instead of 4, what we can do, we can change it to as per our requirement. So let it change to 2 and let it be at 6. So once we change the force profile, then close this system. So just observe these two graphs. Right now we have deviation at it between 4 to 6 seconds. So now we have changed the force configuration. So we can again run the simulation. So simulation is complete. So these are the position and velocity for the change in force. So now you can observe that changes are taking place from 2 to 6 seconds in the position as well as in the velocity. So this force displacement is gradually changing at the beginning of 2 seconds. So this was the first parameter, what we just varied. Then the second parameter is to change the model parameters. So in model parameters, what we can do, we can change the stiffness of the spring. We can change the damping coefficient. So in a similar fashion, we'll get the changes in the system performance. So here we just change the force profile. So now what we can do, we can alter the damper and spring parameters. So simply double click spring, and here the spring rate is 1000. We can change it to 2000. Once you are done, click OK. And then again run the simulation for new values. So again, there will be certain changes in the system response. So these are the changes. Okay, so now the deflection has been slightly changed. In the similar fashion, what we can do, we can change the stiffness of the spring. So right now the damping coefficient is 100. We can make it to 500 and then run the simulation. So again, the parameter changes as per the change in the profile. So what we can observe that in this particular example of building this spring mass damper system, we haven't wrote a single line of code, but still we are able to simulate, we are able to generate the model, and we are able to simulate and we are able to assess the performance of the system. So based on the obtained results, what we can do, we can adjust our settings and we can adjust our system configuration parameters. So this was about SimScape, how you can model the system using SimScape. Okay, in last part of this presentation, I'll quickly discuss the third approach of MATLAB programming, that is interactive tools and apps. So for that particular thing, we need to refer to the app section of the MATLAB window, and there we can select the appropriate app, and without writing a single line of code, we are able to solve a particular problem. The problem what we are considering in this particular presentation is to develop a correlation between temperature and coefficient of thermal expansion. So many a times it is we are asked to perform certain experiments, and we try to develop certain correlation between the observation of the experiment. So that kind of thing can be easily done using the curve fitting toolbox of the MATLAB. So first let me clear the workspace. So this is the sample observation that we will utilize. There is a temperature and thermal coefficient of thermal expansion data. Okay, so there are 236 entries in the data set. What we are trying to do, we are trying to generate the correlation between temperature and thermal thermal coefficient for a particular experiment. So let us load the data first. So this is the default data available in the MATLAB. So it has got temperature observation for certain experiment. So there are 236 values in this data set, temperature values. And similarly, we have 236 corresponding 236 values of thermal expansion. So we are trying to develop correlation between these two data. So what we can do, we can fit a regression, or we can generate a curve fitting model for the data, and we can establish certain relationship between these two parameters. So for that, simply go to the apps tab. So in apps tab, we can find a curve fitting app. So we'll simply click this curve fitting app. So one new window will open. So this is the default view of the curve fitting toolbox. So here we have fit name, then X data, Y data, Z data, weights, then different models, different methods, and this is the result tab. So first of all, observe the workspace. We got two data, temperature and thermal expansion. So we can import that data directly into the curve fitting app. So simply click the X data and it will show the available data in the workspace. So let us select the temperature data as the X data. So it will automatically generate a plot. And then select the thermal expansion as the Y data. So once you select the data, this app will generate automatic fitting to the data. So these black dots we can see over here, this is the data what we have. And this blue line is the default curve generated by MATLAB. So as we can see that this is not the correct representation of the data. This is not giving us the current relationship or the correct relationship between the data set. And in the result pane or in the result tab, what we are getting? We are getting the equation of the fit with the certain parameters to evaluate the fit. So this straight line fit is not applicable in our case. So it is polynomial of degree one. So let us change the degree of the polynomials and see how the data behaves. So I'm changing that degree of polynomial to 2. So this curve form changes. Again, it is not appropriate or acceptable. Then let us change it to 3. So again, it changes. Then change it to 4. So this is quite good fit. And if we go for other higher order polynomial, fifth order, it is somehow overfitted. So we can see that this fifth order polynomial is giving us the proper representation of the data. So what is proper representation of the data means we are getting the fitting equation. So this is the equation of the polynomial which has been generated by the system. This is the fifth order polynomial. Since we generated the fifth order polynomial, so it is the fifth order polynomial equation, and this is the coefficient of those polynomials. This is the coefficient, these are the coefficients of those polynomials. So that relationship between temperature and the thermal coefficient of thermal expansion for this particular experiment, you can directly define using this particular polynomial equation, and you can analyze the goodness of the fit using the root mean square error. Or root mean square error is the indicator, so we have to look for the small root mean square error in the fitting operation. So this is the normal fitting of the curve or normal fitting of the data or establishment of the relationship between the two parameters using the curve fitting technique. So once you are done with the fitting, you can simply generate the MATLAB code for that. So it will automatically generate the MATLAB code for this operation what you just performed. So you need not to write a single piece or single line of code. Just by using this particular app, you can solve the problem. So this is another way of using or solving the problem. Okay, but the most important part in all these three problems is the problem formulation itself. How you are formulating the problem or what is the nature of your problem that you are going to solve is of prime importance. So this is the third way of solving the problem. So in the similar fashion, what you can do, you can go for the optimization toolbox also, where you can specify the objective function as well as the constraint equation to solve the optimization problem. Okay, due to time constraint, I am not going for the optimization problem. So here is the summary of this particular session. That MATLAB and Simulink is a versatile tool which can be used for solving many problems. And the best part of MATLAB and Simulink is it's their extensive documentation help and adaptation to the industry standards. So that's why MATLAB and Simulink is quite popular due to documentation and due to help. And mechanical system modeling is possible from analysis viewpoint. So you can perform various analysis, you can perform complex analysis using MATLAB and Simulink as a simulation or modeling tool. So I thank you all for your patient listening. So if you have any questions.
Any participants, if they have any questions, they can raise. You can unmute yourself and can ask.
Sir, could you provide a soft copy of Simulink documentation?
Soft copy of?
Simulink documentation.
This presentation?
Not presentation, sir, any book. soft copy of book.
So as far as for Simscape, any as per my knowledge, books are not available. What you can get some live demos on the MATLAB help, as well as you need to look for the MATLAB videos or MATLAB central platform where you'll have certain videos or some help files or some demos for different problems.
Yeah, HTTP में है वो.
बोल रहे हैं. कौन सा ये अपना इसका क्या?
FDP, FDP अकल वाला कुछ
कॉलेज. अपना आपने रोक दिया.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Abhishek sir, for great learning experience for us. In mechanical engineering especially, you have taken the exact spring damper mass system and then curve fitting, which is a very essential part of our research work. So we are very grateful to listen to you, and we hope in third day of the ET session, you will be explaining more about the again robotic system simulation and modeling. We are eagerly waiting for that session also. Thank you very much.
And thanks to all the organizers as well as the participants for patient listening. And definitely, sir, I am also looking forward for the third day where I can discuss something about robotics. Once again, thank you very much for this opportunity. Thank you, Sanjay, sir.
Thank you very much, sir.
Okay. Shall I leave?
Yes, sir. Sure.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. So all participants, today's we are at the end of third session. So we will continue tomorrow at 10 a.m. sharply. There we will have a session from Srinivas sir and then Patel sir. And then we will see the design and experiments. I hope all of you have the schedules. We will follow that. Any queries and any questions you can have, you can directly message in the message personally. Okay, my number is there in the WhatsApp group. Shubham sir, anything you want to ask?
Sir, attendance link.
Sir, I take the attendance from the attendee list in the Zoom itself, in the software itself.
Okay, sir. So we can leave the meeting.
Yeah, you can leave the meeting.
Okay. Sir, this is Pradeep Parikh.
Yeah.
So where can we get the recorded video? As sir has already told in the morning that
sir, the procedure is that after completing this FTP, I have to assemble all the video of all the sessions, and then I will provide it in YouTube, and the link will be provided to your mail.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Any queries again?
Yes, sir. Sir, what about the test, sir, that will be there at the end?
Sir, after completing of all the sessions, yes, the last session is for feedback and assessment. There you will have?
Because it started, I know, sir. So our college will be over by 1:30. So then it's very difficult when you go back.
It will not be Saturday, it will be Friday, sir.
Okay, then it should be fine, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you. We will meet you tomorrow in the morning at 10 a.m. Thank you. Sir.